Shabbat Shalom, everyone.
Shabbat Shalom.
Welcome to Brimi's Torah portion for this week. And we're going to be looking at Deuteronomy chapter 32. Ha'azinu, give ear, or listen, or Shema, or however you want to say that. So if you'll turn there in your scriptures and follow along with me so we don't get lost, I would appreciate that. What we're going to be talking about this week is the tag, if you want to call it that, of last week's teaching, where Yah has commanded Moshe to write a song as a witness against Israel. And it's found in this chapter, this book, Deuteronomy 32. And actually the song itself is found in chapters 1 through 43. So actually the song that he wrote ends at verse 43.
Chapters or verses?
Verses.
Oh, okay.
1 through 43. Deuteronomy 32, and looking at verse 1, says, "Give ear, O heavens, and I will speak, and let the earth hear the words of my mouth." If we look at give ear, the term give ear there, and we examine that in the Hebrew, we find that the word that was used there in Hebrew is azan. Azan means to listen or to pay attention. You know, I think that far too many times people that sit in different services, different kinds, and different churches, they really don't listen and really don't pay attention. They hear what he's saying, but they really don't put that into the perspective of where I'm going to take that and do something with it. It's made up, if you look at the word azan in Hebrew, it's formed with the aleph, which means a strong leader or represents a strong leader. And then we have the letter Zion, which means to pierce. And then we have the last letter, which is the Nun, which means the sun. And so when we combine those three letters that make up the parent root of the word Azan, what we have then is the sun, the strong leader who was pierced. Hear him. And so what does Yah tell us that we will hear in these last days is Yahshua. And so we see him portrayed in this verse. The gematria that's used for the word azan is 58. And it means the ear, or to hear, and to obey. And so we go right back to the same thing as Shema means. To hear with the intention of obeying. Same thing we find here. And then earth, of course, is Eretz. But here the context of Eretz means the whole of the earth. In other words, when he says, give ear, he's speaking to the entire earth and saying, no matter where you are, listen and pay attention to what is about to be said. And what follows then are the words of the song that's commanded by Yah and written by the hand of Moshe, which would stand as a witness against Israel down through the generations if they failed to obey Yah's voice. Why would he give them a witness against them? We're going to talk about it some more, but know up front that anytime he does something like this, it is for our benefit. He doesn't do things to us. He does things for us. And so if he places a witness for us or against us, he's doing it for us. And it's to prevent us from straying. In verse 2, Deuteronomy 32, verse 2, it says, "May my teaching drop as the rain, my speech distill as the dew, like gentle rain upon the tender grass, and like showers upon the herb." In other words, he's saying, accept the words of this song as though I am speaking to you in gentleness. And what I want you to do, I'm not speaking to you harshly. The things that I'm saying to you, he says, are not a threat to you. The things that I'm saying in the song should be an encouragement to you. And now they are spoken softly to you. Moshe's teaching is Yahweh's teaching. And Moshe's speech is Yahweh's speech. So what Moses is presenting is from the mouth of our Father. He said that it would fall as distilled water. I want you to know that the word distilled here has very special meaning. The Hebrew word for it is nazal, to flow like water. Now you're going to see that in another place here in a moment. To flow like water. The gematria is 87, the number 87, and it in itself means to flow or to run. The nun, as seen here in the word nazal, means again pierced. The lamed means teaches and leads. So we take those two letters, and that's what they mean. To teach and to lead. The dew. He said it'll fall as gentle as the dew. And that word is tall, T-A-L. And it means a cover or a covering. Now I hope you're beginning to see that there are different Hebrew words that can mean exactly the same thing. And so you have to fit them into the context again of what's being said. Yahweh's desire then was that his instructions should flow as water and provide a covering for Israel, to remind them that when they sin, he sees it. Do you remember that there's another verse of scripture that says, be sure that your sins will find you out? And so when our sins find us out, we stand before Elohim for judgment. And so it's much better if we curtail that before we have to stand before him. And so this is his desire. In Psalm 119:11, for example, he says, I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. This is what King David does. So you see, Yahweh is giving a song to Moses, putting it out there as a witness against Israel. And what it is it's his word in song that we might know his word and we might not sin against him. We might not rise up in rebellion against him. The understanding then of distilled is water that is pure, undefiled, and unpolluted. As Brad Scott would teach, it's the headwaters. It's the water that falls on the top of the mountain before it has a chance to run downstream and pick up all the pollutants of the earth and so forth. And so Brad always teaches, go to the top of the mountain and drink the water there, where it's the purest. The word law is from the Hebrew word Torah. And Torah, as we have learned, does not mean law. It is not nomos, as you find in the Greek. It is teachings and instructions. Torah is also from the Hebrew word Yara. And Yara here means to flow as water. Remember, we just looked at another word that meant to flow as water. It should be understood, therefore, that this song that Moses is giving us here has its roots in the rich soil of Yah's teaching and instructions. Now, let's pause for just a moment and ask ourselves a question. Does Yah ever deviate from his word? So everything he is going to tell us is going to be attached to the Torah. Attached to his word. The roots of it are going to be in the Torah. And so that's true here as well. Deuteronomy 32, 3 and 4. He says, "For I will proclaim the name of Yahweh. Ascribe greatness to our Elohim, the rock. His word is perfect, for all his ways are justice. An Elohim of faithfulness and without iniquity, just and upright is he." What did he just tell us there? What did Moses just explain to us? The character of the living Elohim. He just told us that in every single facet, he is faithful, he is without iniquity, he's just and upright in everything that he does. So we can never look at Yahweh and blame him for something that's going on in our own life. We have to first of all examine ourselves and be truthful with ourselves. Isn't that what Shaul told us? He said, examine yourselves to see that you're in the faith. So make sure that we are in the faith. We examine ourselves first. If we'll examine ourselves first, then Yahweh won't have to examine us. He won't have to place such rigid judgment. Rock is used here, is the word in Hebrew tesor, a flint or a hard rock or a place of refuge. Now I would ask you as a congregation and those of you that are out on the internet, when we look at rock as it's used in these verses, which one of those fits in the context? A flint, a hard rock, or a place of refuge? So the meaning is a place of refuge. It's a place to run to, right? It's an escape route. When sin reared its ugly head, Israel might hear the song of Moses and run to the rock for a place of refuge. So what do we do when we run to the rock and we realize that we have transgressed? As we run to him with a contrite heart, we repent, ask forgiveness, and move on, don't we? That is exactly what we should be doing. Deuteronomy 32, verse 5. They have dealt corruptly with him. They are no longer his children because they are blemished. They are crooked and a twisted generation. That's harsh words, but do you remember that he said that they were not his people? But praise Yahweh, he said something else at the end of that. But they will become my people. And so when we look at the harsh words, we need to listen to all of his words, don't we? Not just part that upsets us, but listen to all of it. But here he says, they're blemished, they're crooked, they're twisted. And so he says, they're no longer his children. They're outside of the Torah. Israel dealt corruptly by corrupting themselves. So when it says there in verse 5, they have dealt corruptly, then what they mean is, or what he means is, they corrupted themselves. By polluting themselves through disobedience, they became mum in Hebrew, which means to be stained or to be blemished. And what happens if a sacrifice is stained or blemished? It's unacceptable. In this word, let's look carefully at that word. It's a mem, a wah, or a vav, and a mem. So we have mem, vav, mem. Mem here, in context, represents chaos. The vav, or the wah, represents add. And so when we put those together, the meaning is chaos added to chaos. So when we sin against him, we take chaos and add it to chaos. In other words, it becomes a cycle that we do. Remember, everything is in cycles. And so we add to the cycle of iniquity. As such, the people were not suitable as living sacrifices to Yahweh. Do you know, I'm convinced that today, within most of what we call the religious circles today, that those people who are counting themselves to be living sacrifices are mum. They are stained and blemished, and indeed are not living sacrifices. If I'm going too fast, let me know. Deuteronomy 32 and verse 6 says, "Do you thus repay Yahweh, you foolish and senseless people? Is not He your Father who created you, who made you and established you?" In other words, why are we trying to act like we're fooling Yahweh? Why do we act like we're trying to hide from Him and hide our sin from Him when there is no way that we can do that? Our sin is going to find us out. In verse 7, he says, "Remember the days of old. Consider the years of many generations. Ask your father, and he will show you, your elders, and they will tell you." You know, I found this interesting in this verse because he says, "Remember the days of old and consider the years of many generations." Many generations that went through the study of the Torah. Some of them spending their entire lives to learn the Torah. And he says, then ask your elders and they will tell you. Why should they tell you? Because they know the Torah. I mean, and so it tells us something there that our purpose in learning the Torah is to teach other people. Well, we should begin with our children, but some of us don't have children and some of the children are grown up. But I shouldn't say we. Let me back up and apologize for using the word we. I failed in that with my children because I didn't know that I was supposed to walk in the Torah. And so I failed to teach my children. As a result of that, they have failed to teach their children. And so once again, what I talked about a moment ago goes on and on and on. The cycle is repeated. Chaos is added to chaos. And you wind up with what you have today. Allow me to take the liberty of paraphrasing verse 6 again. This is my paraphrase of verse 6. This is me, okay? "Do you suppose that you can take upon yourselves the wages of your sins and offer that to Yahweh and bribe Him to redeem you?" This is the way I see verse 6. That's the way I look at what it is saying there. Verse 7 that we just read here goes back to Psalm 44. So if you want to turn there, you can, but I'll read it for you. Psalm 44, verse 1. "To the choir master, a maskil of the sons of Korah. O Elohim, we have heard with our ears. Our fathers have told us what deeds you performed in their days and the days of old." Now, what did you just tell us a while ago? Go back to the days of old, right? "You with your own hand drove out the nations, but them you planted, you afflicted the peoples, but them you set free. For not by their own sword did they win the land, nor did their own arm save them. But your right arm and right hand and your arm and the light of your face, for you delighted in them. You are my king, O Elohim. Ordain salvation for Yaakov." Do you remember last week when we were watching Rico? And by the way, we'll probably wrap it up today. And what did he say? We don't know how to honor the king. How would we honor if he came in? You know, I can't say that of everyone seated in this room because I believe everyone that's seated in this room today knows how to honor the king. I believe you do. I believe you understand that you'd be on your face worshiping Him. And I am confident of that. He said, "Through you we push down our foes. Through your name we tread down those who rise up against us. For not in my bow do I trust, nor can my sword save me. But you have saved us from our foes and have put shame to those who hate us." So the psalmist knew very well. Moshe almost quotes the psalmist there. In 32 verse 8, When the Most High gave to the nations their inheritance, when he divided mankind, he fixed the borders of the peoples according to the number of the sons of Elohim. The nations, the word that's used here as nations, in Hebrew, is the word goy. And we've all learned what goy means. Goy, the people of a nation, the back or the middle. When I read that, it stopped me cold because I thought, what has that got to do with anything, the back or the middle? But it does have meaning. Let's examine this same verse, though, from the King James Version. Every now and then, I find a verse of Scripture where the King James is much clearer to me than the other verses are. That's rare because usually it's just the opposite. But in this case, I want you to look. Let's read it in verse 8 again there, but then I want to look at it again in King James. When the Most High gave to the nations their inheritance, when he divided mankind, he fixed the borders of the peoples according to the number of the sons of Elohim. Now let's look in King James. Here's the way it reads. When the Most High divided the nations their inheritance, when he separated, now listen, when he separated the sons of Adam, he set the bounds of the people according to the number of the children of Israel. Now that reads quite a bit different than what we just read in the other translation, which is the ESV. So notice the obvious difference in the two translations. Yahweh separated the goy, which are the sons of Adam. He placed boundaries between the goy and the children of Israel. See, if I read that in the ESV, I can really get mixed up and confused about what is he talking about? Who are the sons of Adam? Well, he calls them goy. And then he refers to the children of Israel. So the children of Israel and the goy are two different things, right? And so, again, he's saying he's placing boundaries between the goy and the children of Israel. The land belonging to the children of Israel were allotted to the tribes of Israel. He distributed the land according to the size of each tribe. Now, I want you to grasp what I just said there about what we read in the text. He distributed the land, how? According to the size of each tribe. Now, why didn't he do this? Why didn't he say, I'm going to take from this tribe and add to that tribe and balance this thing out so that we're fair and equitable, so that everybody has the same thing?
Sounds like the president.
Okay? He didn't redistribute the people to balance the numbers. Some got more, some got less. Redistribution is not Yah's way of doing things. It's very clear from the text. Deuteronomy 32:9. But Yahweh's portion is his people, Jacob or Yaakov, his allotted heritage. Allotted, let's look at the Hebrew for that word. Because Jacob is his allotted heritage, he says. Hevel, to bind something by wrapping it around with a rope. This is taken from another Hebrew word, which is chabal. It means to bind by a pledge. How do we bind by a pledge? We make a covenant, and we have a binding pledge. So if I look at that, it says he is wrapped around with a rope, or that he is bound by a pledge. That is what Yahweh is trying to tell us. It's talking about Yaakov. He made Yaakov a pledge. Did he make the same pledge to Yaakov's father and his father? Yes. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, right down the line, right? Deuteronomy 32:10. He found him in a desert land, and in the howling waste of the wilderness, he encircled him, he cared for him, He kept him as the apple of his eye. Now we have to stop and think. We are the children of Israel. We are the offspring of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Does he care for us? Yes. What does it mean, though, to be the apple of Yah's eye? You know, I've heard that term for many years, and I never questioned, what does that mean? What does it mean I'm the apple of his eye? Well, in Hebrew, it does have a meaning. The word apple itself is eshon. It's a concrete word in Hebrew, meaning fire. Another meaning is, listen to this now, another meaning is charred wood after being burned in fire. So when he says you're the apple of his eye, what in the world is he actually saying there? Look up there. Jacob was cleansed in the purifying fire of Yah, and Yah kept him. He encircled him and protected him and so forth. Why? Because he was like charred wood after the fire. Charred wood is purified. It's been in the fire. And so this is actually what he's talking about when he says, you're the apple of my eye. The word kept. He kept Yaakov, it says. Nazar. To guard, to protect, and maintain, to preserve. And so, because he was cleansed in the fire, he guarded him, protected him, maintained and preserved him. Now that ought to tell us something, because doesn't he tell us that we're going to be purified through as though by fire? So the same thing is happening to the children of Israel that happened to the father Yaakov. In verse 11, it says, like an eagle that stirs up its nest, that flutters over its young, spreading out its wings, catching them, bearing them on its pinions. Now I want to share with all of you something. I read several commentaries on Deuteronomy 32:11, and they were saying in all of those commentaries that is just an old wives' tale. That eagles don't catch their young on their wings. That's aerodynamically impossible, and that cannot happen. Well, look at verse 32:11 and tell me who said that. Who do you think knows more about his creation, him or them?
Yes, since he made it all.
He's the one had Moshe write this. And look at it again, spreading out its wings, catching them, and bearing them on his pinions. So what am I to believe here? I'm to believe that that's exactly what happens. Has anybody seen it? Maybe nobody's ever seen that, but I can assure you from the word of Yah that it happens, regardless of what the commentators say. Look at this, though. This is out of the Wheaton, Illinois Scripture Press publication. When young eagles are learning to fly, the mother eagle flies under them with her wings spread out to catch them. So that is in Wheaton College, I guess we'd call it today. So they knew it. They believe it. I believe it. If Yah said it, I believe it. It's that simple. While there seems to be widespread disagreement on this, I have but one thing to say. Did Yahweh say it?
Yes, he did.
Who will we choose to believe? Deuteronomy 32 and following. Yahweh alone guided him. No foreign god was with him. He made him ride on the high places of the land, and he ate the produce of the field, and he suckled him with honey out of the rock and oil out of the flinty rock, curds from the herd and milk from the flock, with fat of lambs, rams of Bashan, and goats with the very finest of wheat, and you drank foaming wine made with the blood of the grape. Now, my wife and all the rest of you, I guess the ladies in here, can tell you from making kefir water what this is talking about. What's it talking about when it's talking about foaming grapes? It's not all that hard to understand, is it, when you talk about making kefir water? I can't tell you how many times I've seen that in my life, pop a top on one of them in here and get it everywhere. Herein is a reminder that Israel is led by Yahweh and Yahweh alone. When Israel follows the sovereign of the universe, they are blessed beyond measure. The finest of the flocks and of the fields are theirs when we follow Yahweh. Verse 15 tells us that Yeshurun grew fat and kicked. You grew fat, stout, and sleek, he says. Then he forsook Elohim, who made him, and scoffed at the rock of his salvation. Who's Yeshurun? Yeshurun in Hebrew means upright. Means Yeshurun, a symbolic name for Israel. So you see, Yeshurun in Hebrew means Israel, or the children of Israel, if you will. But what does it mean to grow fat? To grow fat means to be full of oil. In Hebrew, that's what it means, to be full of oil. Now, what do you think composes fat in the body?
Liver, kidney.
Yeah. But I'm talking about fat is oily substance. You remember they used to use lard in cooking? Well, they still do, by the way.
Well, not us.
Well, I said they.
Yeah.
I'm trying to be like Shaul. They do one thing, we do something different, right? But my point is, fat is oil. Fat is used as oil. So when he says you're full of oil, kicked. He says, you kicked. Ba'at means to trample down. That is, to despise. So when he says, you kicked, what does he mean? You despised me. You came to the place where you despised Yahweh, your Elohim. He says, you became stout. Abba, thick, means you become thick. But let's look for understanding to the letters of that word. Look and notice that Abba begins with the ayin. The ayin pictures a twisted rope, meaning darkness. And the bet that you see means a tent. Now I hope you can see up there. The letters, ayin and bet, is the first two letters in that word. When I combine those two letters, I get the meaning dark inside. So, what does he say? You came to the place where you were full of yourself, you despised me, and you became darkness inside. In other words, you lost the light. You scoffed, he said. Nobam, to fall away. So when those things occur, what happens is you fall away. You apostatize and put yourself in a very dangerous position. Israel grew fat, that is self-sufficient, and began to be disobedient and filled with darkness. Then they fell away from the covenant with Yahweh. So this is what he's telling us. And in this song, by the way, remember, he says it's a witness against you. And so why is he publishing this song? So that Israel will be aware of the song and not make those mistakes again. But what do you think is going to happen to the people that are out there in the religious system that are convinced that the Old Testament is not for them. They don't need that. And they don't have this guidance in their life, and so what happens? They've actually fallen away, and they don't even realize that they have put distance between the Creator and them because they are not obeying His Torah. In the following verses, Yahweh reminds them of the reasons for their fall. And so let's examine now and make sure that we're not in one of these categories and that we have protected ourselves so we don't get into one of these categories. He says, they stirred him to jealousy with strange gods. With abominations, they provoked him to anger. Now, what exactly is an idol? A strange god, right? He says they're strange gods, idols are. Well, did we ever wallow in strange gods and idols? Absolutely, you know. And so we want to make sure that we don't do that again, that we keep the feasts and festivals that He commanded, not the ones that man commanded. We don't want to get involved in things that Yahweh says are an abomination to Him. And by the way, we're being bombarded by the gay and lesbian groups to accept their lifestyle. And I will not accept their lifestyle because Yah has said it is an abomination to Him. Doesn't mean that I don't love them. Doesn't mean I don't think they deserve to have a job or whatever. It means I don't agree with their lifestyle, and I never will. They sacrifice to demons. Stop. This is one of those places that I've told you in the past that in the Tanakh, you would find the word demons. The word demons, though, even in the Tanakh, is taken from a Greek word. So how is that in the Tanakh, you say? Well, how did Genesis get to be the first book of the Scriptures when that's Greek? Why don't we call it what it really is, Bereshit, instead of Genesis? So the Greek has came in and polluted the Tanakh. I just want you to know that, okay? So what about these demons? They sacrificed to demons that were no gods. I want you to please highlight that and pay attention to that. That Yahweh is speaking here, and He says they sacrificed to demons that were no gods. In other words, these demons have no power, no authority, they're nothing, okay? Look what He says at the next one. To gods they had never known, to new gods that had come when? Recently. Whom your fathers had never dreaded. Why didn't they dread them?
Because they weren't there.
They weren't there. Okay? There was no need to dread them. This is why I have said repeatedly, why is the New Testament, the Brit Hadashah, is full of these things about demons, but you don't find it in the Tanakh. Well, there has to be a reason. And let's look. The word demons as used here in the Hebrew, if you'll look, Lee pointed out to me that some people do pronounce this shed, but you also have the pronunciation up there of shade. It's made of what two Hebrew letters?
Shin and
Dalet. Shin and Dalet, right? The letters are Shin, Dalet. The Shin pictures... Before I go into this, ladies, please forgive me if this comes across as crude, but this is Yahweh's teaching and not mine. So, let's look. The Shin pictures the two front teeth. The Dalet pictures a tent door that dangles down. When the letters are combined, they mean two that dangle. This in turn pictures breasts which dangle down. What has that got to do with demons? Before we get too carried away, it means the teats of a goat idol. To the Hebrew, a demon is an idol. An idol is a god. Notice that Yahweh tells us that demons were no gods. An idol is no god. Only in our warped mind is an idol a god. And if we accept idolatry, then we accept demonology. 1 Corinthians 8, 4. Look at what Shaul says. And pay attention to it. This is Shaul. This is in the New Testament. Therefore, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that an idol has no real existence, and that there is no Elohim but one. So a demon, beloved people, has no real existence. Only in our mind. Back to the text. Verse 18 of Deuteronomy 32. You were unmindful of the rock that bore you, and you forgot the Elohim who gave you birth. Yahweh saw it and spurned them because of the provocation of his sons and his daughters. And he said, I will hide my face from them. I will see what their end will be. For they are a perverse generation, children in whom there is no faithfulness. Perverse. He says they are perverse. In Hebrew, that word is tapuchah, and it means to pour out or go a different direction. To be perverse or to be upside down. Now, I'd like to add something to perverse. I go along with all of those definitions there. I'd like to add one more, to be backwards. And I'll show you why in a moment. Faithfulness. Do you remember the word emunah? What does emunah mean, somebody?
Faith.
Faithfulness is what word? Amun. Something that grabs hold or supports something else. The passing of strength or skill to the next generation. It's the same meaning as eminah. The failure of Israel to grab hold of the Torah, to go a different direction, has resulted in a perverted understanding of the Scripture. Hebrew is read right to left. English is backwards, left to right. Not only is it upside down, but it's backwards. No wonder we can't understand. Even our language is backwards, and our understanding of Scripture, therefore, is upside down. We put the cart before the horse. We take the New Testament, kick the Old Testament out in the field and say, I don't need that anymore. And try to learn from a commentary, which is what the Brit Hadashah is, the New Testament, is a commentary on the Tanakh. So if you're going to read a commentary, how are you going to know what the commentary is talking about if you don't have what it refers to begin with? Verse 21. They have made me jealous with what is no God. Now, how many times, beloved, has he just told us that these things are not gods? They have provoked me to anger with their idols. So I will make them jealous with those who are no people. I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation. Verse 22 and 23, for a fire is kindled in my anger, and it burns to the depths of Sheol. Devours the earth and its increase, and sets on fire the foundations of the mountains. And I will heap disasters upon them. I will spend my arrows on them. I was absolutely amazed. I do know. Yah speaks to my heart about certain words I see. And I begin to say, why is that word there? What does that mean? What does he mean, I'll spend my arrows on them? Do you really picture Yahweh up there in the heavens somewhere and he's launching arrows with a bow on the people of Israel that are on the earth? But that's what it says, I'll spend my arrows on them. So I said to myself, self said I, what are these arrows talking about? What is he talking about? I find the term arrows, therefore, very interesting. And let's look. It is, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, chutz. It means as dividing flesh. The Het, which is the first letter, pictures a wall of separation. The Zadik, which is the next one, pictures a man lying on his side, if you look at it in the older Hebrew. Together they mean wall of sides. It's like having a tent that has sides, walls, but in the middle is another wall, okay, that divides the tent into two halves. And so this is what this is presenting. So what is he really telling us here? These arrows were to divide flesh from flesh, to divide Israel into various camps. It also divided at one time the northern and southern kingdom, right? These are the arrows which Yahweh has launched to divide flesh. We have the 12 tribes, and we're divided into the 12 tribes of Israel. And when we go into the kingdom, it says we'll all enter through one of the gates that's identified with one of the tribes of Israel. And one of them is not named First Baptist, Second Baptist, Methodist. It's the tribes of Israel. They shall be wasted with hunger and devoured by plague and poisonous pestilence. I will send the teeth of the beast against them with the venom of things that crawl in the dust. Outdoors the sword shall bereave and indoor terror for the young man and the woman alike, the nursing child with the man of gray hairs. I would have said, I will cut them to pieces. I will wipe them from human memory. Wow. Pretty tough stuff there, right? Had I not feared provocation by the enemy. See, he's telling us something there. He's not saying it's because we're so good. He's saying it's because of the enemy and what the enemy would think if I destroyed my people Israel. He says, lest their adversaries should misunderstand, lest they should say, our hand is triumphant. It was not Yahweh who did all this. So please understand, what he does for himself, okay? He does for himself. This should cut to our very heart, that our Creator would be so displeased with our behavior that he considered destroying us. And by the way, he is going to destroy those who do not repent, isn't he? We're going to be cleansed by fire. They're going to be destroyed by fire. Were it not for his own namesake, he would have done so. Do you remember there was a couple of occasions where he told Moses, get out of the way, stand back, and I'm going to destroy them. Mm-hmm. And Moses pleaded for the children of Israel. Mm-hmm. Today, Moses is still pleading for us. He's doing so through this song. He's still pleading for Israel. Verse 28. For they are a nation void of counsel, and there is no understanding in them. Counsel. Yaatz in Hebrew. Yaatz. Resolve, determination, or purpose. And so when I look at that, and they're void of counsel, means they have no determination of anything and have no purpose in life. That is out there wandering around with no direction. Moving away from the Torah, the nation lost its resolve, determination, and purpose. Without the counsel of the Torah, Israel is incapable of discerning Yah's will for them. How many times have you heard a fellow Christian say, I sure wish I knew what God's will for me is. Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to pray to see what God's will for my life is. Well, all we need to do is do some study. He'll tell us what His will for us is. If they were wise, they would understand this. They would discern their latter end. In other words, he would say they would discern their latter end. Now let me ask you a question to ponder. What does it mean when he says they would discern their latter end? How would we know about our latter end? Because we go back to the beginning. Okay? But because we fail to understand the significance of the Torah, we threw it away for a long time. We threw away the beginning that tells us what the end will be. And many people are still in that way. So how can you discern your end if you didn't know your beginning? Proverbs 10:8 says this way, "The wise of heart will receive commandments, but a babbling fool will come to ruin." Boy, wouldn't some of the church people love to hear that? Now, because you don't accept the commandments, you're a babbling fool. I'm glad it's Yahweh who told them that, not me. I just read what he says. Wisdom comes from knowing and keeping commandments. Not just knowing them, but keeping them as well. Psalm 119:11 says it this way, "I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you." If I don't store up his word in my heart, then I will sin against him. Do you understand that? Okay. Verse 30, "How could one have chased 1,000 and two have put 10,000 to flight unless their rock had sold them and Yahweh had given them up?" The words "had sold them" and "had given them" shows a past tense. However, Moshe is speaking of a time in the future when Israel would fall. Judges 2:11 says, "And the people of Israel did what was evil in the sight of Yahweh and served the Baals." What are the Baals? Idols, foreign gods, which Yahweh says are no gods at all. And in the end will be crushed. Continuing with Judges 2, verse 12. "And they abandoned Yahweh, the Elohim of their fathers, who had brought them out of the land of Egypt. They went after other gods from among the gods of the peoples who were around them and bowed down to them, and they provoked Yahweh to anger. They abandoned Yahweh and served the Baals and the Ashtaroth." Did we do that?
Yes.
Did we have Ashtaroth trees in our house on December the 25th?
Yes.
Just in one example. "So the anger of Yahweh was kindled against Israel, and he gave them over to plunderers who plundered them, and he sold them into the hand of their surrounding enemies, so that they could no longer withstand their enemies." Beloved, let me share with you for just a moment how serious this is getting in our country. When Judges is talking about this, do you know that it was on television just this morning and last night that the University of Missouri, the professors on the campus are now encouraging students to practice Wicca
and other
and satanic worship,
yeah,
and all these other things.
Practicing on campus.
And if he didn't let these people get away with it, we're not going to get away with it. We as a country are becoming more and more wicked. More and more transgressing of the Torah. More and more evil. And it just has to somewhere come to an end. He is a just Elohim, and I'm telling you, we have just about stretched the rubber band as far as it's going to go. Pretty soon it's going to break. And when it does, it will rain hell on this earth. I'm here to tell you. So we can just watch for it. Deuteronomy 32:31. "For their rock is not as our rock. Our enemies are by themselves. For their vine comes from the vine of Sodom and from the fields of Gomorrah. Their grapes are grapes of poison. Their clusters are bitter. Their wine is the poison of serpents and the cruel venom of asps. Is not this laid up in store with me, sealed up in my treasuries? What is he saying? Am I not mindful of these transgressions? Am I not mindful of this iniquity and evil? He's saying, yeah, I've stored it up. It's in my treasury. He says, vengeance is mine in recompense. For the time when their foot shall slip, for the day of their calamity is at hand, and their doom comes swiftly. I believe that speaks volumes to what's happening in this country. We have really become a vile, vile nation. Yahweh will deal with sin. It will be exposed and recompense will become a reality. You know, he has held back his wrath for so long. Can you imagine when it's released, what it's going to be like? Hebrews 10 verse 30 says, for we know him who said, vengeance is mine, I will repay. And again, the master will judge his people. It is a fearful thing to fall in the hands of the living Elohim. Verse 36, for Yahweh will vindicate his people, have compassion on his servants, when he sees that their power is gone, and there is none remaining, bond or free. Then he will say, where are their gods, the rock in which they took refuge, who ate the fat of their sacrifices and drank the wine of their drink offering? Let them rise up and help you. Let them be your protection. See now that I, even I, am he, and there is no god beside me. I kill and I make alive, I wound and I heal, and there is none that can deliver out of my hand. For I lift up my hand to heaven and swear, as I live forever, if I sharpen my flashing sword and my hand takes hold on judgment, I will take vengeance on my adversaries and will repay those who hate me. I will make my arrows drunk with blood, and my sword shall devour flesh with the blood of the slain and the captives, from the long-haired heads of the enemy. Rejoice with him, O heavens. Bow down to him, all gods. For he avenges the blood of his children and takes vengeance on his adversaries. These verses are directed at those who have fallen away. Those who fall into apostasy. In verse 44 and following, it says, Moses came and recited all the words of this song in the hearing of the people, he and Joshua the son of Nun. And when Moses had finished speaking all these words to all Israel, he said to them, take to heart all the words by which I am warning you today, that you may command them to your children, and that they may be careful to do all the words of this law. Now, we have seen over and over, time and time again, how Yahweh tries to protect us by his encouragement to keep the commandments. If you don't keep the commandments, you will sin. It is the wisdom of knowing those commandments and doing them that keeps you from transgression. And if you're not going to do that, you certainly will fall into sin. Why? Because verse 47 tells you, for it is no empty word for you, but it is your very life. And by this word you shall live long in the land that you are going over the Jordan to possess. So what gives us life? The Torah. It is no empty word, he says. Empty is the word ryk, which means empty of contents. It pictures a container where all its contents have been drawn out. It's empty. So I want you to think for just a moment what this is talking about. This is a person who has emptied themselves of the Torah and have become nothing but an empty shell. There is nothing inside of them. They are cold and they are dead. Let's look at the way this is formed, this word. The resh represents the head, and the kof means distinguish. And when we combine the two, it means the head which cannot distinguish. So what he's saying here when he says it's not an empty word, it's a word that has meaning, it's a word that has life. And so when he says when you cast this word aside, you become empty-headed. You become that which cannot distinguish right from wrong. In other words, you cease to be a priest, because that is the calling of a priest. Without the Torah in his heart and in his mind, a person is like an empty container. Torah is life. Without it, a person is walking among the walking dead. They're a walking dead person, actually, is what he's saying. Verse 48 and following, that very day Yahweh spoke to Moses, go up this mountain of Abarim, Mount Nebo, which is in the land of Moab, opposite Jericho, and view the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the people of Israel. So Moses, I want you to climb Mount Nebo. When you get up there, I want you to survey the land that I'm giving to the people of Israel. He says, because you broke faith with me in the midst of the people of Israel, at the waters of Meribah Kadesh, in the wilderness of Zin, and because you did not treat me as holy in the midst of the people of Israel. What is he saying? In Numbers 20, verse 7, Yahweh spoke to Moses, saying, take the staff, assemble the congregation, you and Aaron your brother, and tell the rock before their eyes to yield its water. So you shall bring water out of the rock and give drink to the congregation and their cattle. So what is he supposed to do?
Speak to
the rock, right? Command the rock. Mm-hmm. So Moses took the staff from before Yahweh as he commanded him. Then Moses and Aaron gathered the assembly together before the rock, and he said to them, hear now, you rebels, shall we bring water for you out of this rock? So it didn't matter. I hear sermon after sermon saying he was supposed to speak to the rock and he struck the rock and that's why Yahweh did this. No. It has nothing whatsoever to do with that. What it has to do with is Moses took for himself the glory that belonged to Yahweh. He and Aaron took credit for making the water come out of the rock. And Moses lifted up his hand and struck the rock with his staff twice. And water came out abundantly, and the congregation drank, and their livestock. And Yahweh said to Moses and Aaron, because you did not believe in me to uphold as holy in the eyes of the people of Israel, therefore you shall not bring this assembly into the land that I am giving them. So he's saying, go up to Mount Nebo, look at the land, because you're not going to go in. You're not going in the land that flows with milk and honey, because you did not respect me. Okay? For you shall see the land before you, but you shall not go there, into the land that I'm giving to the people of Israel. Moses was allowed then to see the land from Mount Nebo, but he was not allowed to cross the Jordan. Shalom Aleichem.